Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be discussing this relatively recent paper that presents a pretty strong evidence for essentially another Tunguska-like event, another cometary explosion somewhere in the upper atmosphere that created an extremely powerful explosion in the skies approximately 12,000 years ago that might have actually destroyed a really large part of the ancient Chile, with the obvious signs of the destruction being present across a pretty large area, with some of the pieces being at least 80 kilometers away from one another. And so let's discuss this new paper, what was discovered, and most importantly, what it sort of means to our understanding of these unusual events and these unusual collisions. Now, first of all, not so long ago, we've already discussed this other really interesting event, and this other really interesting study that suggested an ancient huge comet might have fell apart most likely a few thousand years ago, potentially creating some really interesting effects in the night skies and also causing a lot of smaller collisions to occur over the next few hundreds of years. This video should be popping up somewhere right there. We've also discussed this other paper, a somewhat controversial paper mostly because of the science in it, that did suggest that a biblical city that we sometimes refer to as Sodom might have been destroyed by a cometary explosion similar to Tunguska as well. Now, that video should be somewhere right there as well, and we'll discuss more about the follow-ups to this paper in some of the future videos, but the takeaway here is that these Tunguska-like events, these extremely powerful explosions, most likely caused by a relatively large rock, probably about this big in size, so this is about 65 meters, or just over 200 feet in diameter, these events do seem to be relatively frequent, or at least in terms of frequency, they might happen at least once every 100 to 200 years. And in some cases, nothing actually even reaches the surface. So for example, in the Tunguska event, that's also another video from somewhere in the past, one of the more likely scenarios here was what's known as the glancing impact, with the comet itself, with the cometary piece, kind of passing somewhere in the upper atmosphere, exploding, creating a lot of destruction, with all of the leftover pieces then leaving the atmosphere and never actually coming back. Which is why there was never any impact or anything detected on the ground. And this is of course one of the recent studies from 2020, so we're still learning so much about these unusual events, and we're still trying to understand exactly what happens when a relatively large rock around 200 feet in diameter ends up exploding in the upper atmosphere. Since, statistically speaking, such an event could actually happen in the next few decades, because we're kind of overdue based on previous statistical analysis. So what exactly did they discover? First of all, the discovery of unusual materials in this region in Chile is not actually new. This was already known to us from some of the previous studies. A lot of these deposits were discovered in the Atacama Desert in Chile, the desert that's already known for some of the most inhospitable and some of the most unusual formations that seem to only occur either in this desert or on some other objects, like for example Pluto. One good example is of course the iconic ice formation known as Penitentes that has been discussed in some of the previous videos. And so in a lot of these spots in the desert here, different scientific teams discovered these patches of unusual glass formation with relatively large fields of dark green or black glass occurring in certain patches around the desert. Here's for example a picture of one of these formations that you can find in the paper in the description. And because normally glasses form in very high temperatures, especially when it comes to desert glass, there are only limited ways for these glasses to be created. For example, one of the previous explanations from previous studies involved volcanoes. But the thing is, there are no other signs of volcanoes in the region, and so explaining this as a volcanic activity would be relatively difficult. But prior to this paper, the most accepted explanation was basically forest fires. And because this region used to be not a desert, it actually used to be a lush forest, this sort of made sense. Forest fires, especially really large forest fires, do have a tendency to sort of change some of the soil underneath and potentially even turn some of the soil into a glass-like compound. But further analysis established that some of these minerals that were discovered in these patches of glass could only be formed in extremely hot conditions, up to about 3000 Fahrenheit, or about 1600 Celsius, so a fire, a forest fire, would very unlikely produce such high temperatures. The most likely temperature right in the middle of a forest fire is usually about half of that, approximately 800 Celsius. So formation of some of these particles and some of these minerals, or essentially what's known as the mineral transition that usually is related to heat, would be kind of difficult to explain if this was just a forest fire. And one such example is this mineral right here. At really high temperatures, zircon has a tendency to turn into this. the mineral known as bdelyite. And by the way, good luck pronouncing this. Honestly, it took me a few tries. Anyway, so this stuff was discovered in some of the samples, suggesting a high temperature transition, with a lot of these smaller pieces of glass also showing evidence of being twisted, folded, rolled, and even thrown while still being molten. In other words, there was definitely some sort of violent event that possibly caused the creation of some of these minerals. Which is obviously something that would happen if a very large airburst would then produce these very powerful hot winds that could have created a lot of these particles. But at the same time, a lot of these other particles, a lot of the other minerals, were also somewhat similar to what the scientists have previously discovered when taking samples from different comets. With the best example here being the comet known as Wild 2. This image right here was taken by Stardust back in 2004. And so a lot of the deposits found in some of these glasses sort of corresponded to similar compounds or similar minerals discovered in some of the comets, such as from the iconic Stardust mission that collected some of these particles. And the composition of some of these minerals seems to be extremely similar to the particles from the Wild 2 comet. And all of this presents pretty strong evidence for a potentially extraterrestrial origin of some of these glass formations in this region. But since this also involves a relatively large region, nearly 80 kilometers in size, the only reasonable explanation here involves some sort of a large aerial explosion, extremely similar to the event that happened in Tunguska back in 1908. And since this was also probably some sort of a forest area back in the days, just like in Tunguska, this probably caused a tremendously powerful destruction, with effects very likely lasting for a very long time. But in terms of the actual science, unfortunately that's really all we know right now. It seems that something very powerful happened, most likely a few thousand years ago, but here there are quite a lot of unanswered questions. One major question that we don't have an answer to right now is when exactly this happened. The preliminary suggestion that it could have happened sometime in the late Pleistocene, which would be around 12,000 years ago. But until some of these samples are dated and until an exact timeline is produced, all of this is just guesswork. Nevertheless, one of the obvious questions here is, did this particular explosion have anything to do with the disappearance of large mammalian species that used to exist in the area? Now that's obviously a really, really far-fetched question to ask, mostly because there's really no cause and effect here. We know these events happen quite a lot, and we know that they do cause a lot of destruction, but to date, none of these explosions have ever been really connected to a major extinction event. So even though it could have affected a relatively large area, chances are the effects themselves were only temporary and did not really affect any species. Either way though, it's definitely way too soon to tell. The disappearance of megafauna approximately 12,000 years ago is still more or less poorly understood. It's been connected to the potential extinction led by humans. It's also been connected to the climate change, sometimes also known as the Younger Dryas. But the question is still more or less open, and there are quite a lot of heated discussions among scientists trying to figure all of this out. But there's definitely no definitive answer. On the other hand, there's also a slight chance that some of the ancient humans that just migrated to this area, very likely a few thousand years prior, could have witnessed some of this as well. Now obviously nobody knows if this was documented by anyone or if there are any cave paintings somewhere showing this event in action, but it's definitely something that one day we could potentially discover. For example, we know that the Australian Aborigines have quite a large variety of stories involving large events that very likely were caused by explosions in the night skies. But at the moment, all of this is of course a really big speculation. And I guess the other question is, in regards to this becoming a desert, there is a chance that maybe this somehow led to the desertification of this area. It's not clear, but it's possible. So all of these questions will hopefully be addressed in some of the future studies. But for now, there's really nothing else to add. A really exciting study, a really exciting discovery, and something you can learn more about by reading the paper in the description below. And so until future discoveries about this event or about this explosion, that's all I wanted to mention. Check out some of the previous videos in regards to various cometary collisions, and make sure to subscribe, share this with someone who loves learning about space and sciences, and maybe come back tomorrow to learn something else. Maybe support this channel on Patreon by joining a channel membership or by buying the wonderful Prison t-shirt that you can find in the description. Stay wonderful, I'll see you tomorrow, and as always, bye bye.